Good evening, church. Thank you for tuning in with us this evening. Let's just bow our heads and pray before we get ready to praise our Lord this evening. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much that we could be here today. You're worthy of all of our praise, and to you is all this glory, God. And I just ask that you open our hearts, that you prepare us for this worship, this music, for your word, God, that we can take something away from this evening, and that we could just feel in community with you. So I ask that you be here with us, that we feel your presence, and that you bless this time that we have together right now. Amen.
Amen.
Man of sorrows, Lamb of God, by his own betrayed, the sin of man and wrath of God has been on Jesus laid. Silent as he stood accused, beaten, mocked, and scorned, bowing to the Father's will, he took a crown of thorns. And oh, that rugged cross, my salvation, when your love poured out over me, and now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto thee. Sent of heaven, God's own Son, to purchase and redeem and reconcile the very ones who nailed him to that tree. And oh, that rugged cross, my salvation, where your love poured, soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto thee. Now my debt is paid, it is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. Whom the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. Now my debt is paid, it is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. When the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. Oh, that rugged cross, my salvation, where your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, and honor unto thee. See, the stone is rolled away. Behold the empty tomb. Alleluia. Risen from the grave, no
Praise God. Church, I want to share with you a passage from Isaiah. This is in chapter 53. So, Isaiah 53, this, from the Old Testament, this is one of the places where it is just so plainly and fully prophesied that our Christ ought to suffer and that he will enter his glory. And this chapter is broken up into four parts. It talks about the person of Jesus and then his sufferings and then his humiliation and lastly, the blessings that his death have for mankind. So I want to read from Isaiah chapter 53. I'll start from verse 3 and I'll jump around a few verses down and I'll let you know where I am just to save some time. But Isaiah 53, chapter 3. He was despised and rejected by mankind, a man of suffering, a man of sorrows, and familiar with pain. Like one from whom people hide their faces, he was despised, and we held him in low esteem. Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering, yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. And jumping down to verse 9, he was assigned a grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, though he had done no violence, nor was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the Lord's will to crush him and cause him to suffer. And though the Lord makes his life an offering for sin, he will see his offspring and prolong his days, and the will of the Lord will prosper in his hand. After he has suffered, he will see the light of life and be satisfied. By his knowledge, my righteous servant will justify many, and he will bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will give him a portion among the great, and he will divide the spoils with the strong, because he poured out his life unto death and was numbered with the transgressors. For he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. And amen. Let's just praise our God and sing to his name.
И так нам просто
Yerusalime, не ступает человек со всем силой. Идешь на вечность, как нам с тобою. Ведь бесконечность проложить своей кровью. Его любовь с Христа тебе кричала. Есть начало, она давно тебя звала, искала, когда во тьме ты болен был, она стояла.
Иисус, Господь всего.
твое возносим выше, возносим выше, возносим выше. Имя твое возносим выше, возносим выше, возносим выше. Имя твое возносим выше, возносим выше, возносим выше. Имя твое возносим выше, возносим выше, возносим выше. Разрушен, тобой спасен я. Снова верно, что воскресли Иисус, Господь всего. Ты сильнее, грех разрушен, тобой спасен я. Снова верно, что воскресли Иисус.
Praise God.
Слава Богу. Dear church, we well thank you so much for joining us and singing this awesome worship. We thank you for tuning in as well as coming here today. Although we're not present in person, but we're here on our screens. And I encourage you that you guys prepare your Bibles and prepare your hearts to the word that's going to be preached tonight. And tonight we welcome Sherwood.
Greetings, church. It is so good to be able to bring the word of God to you tonight, and I bring you God's blessing and grace and peace be to you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Tonight I have a message, I believe, that'll be of hope and encouragement, and I don't have to tell you that if you've been watching the news, there's been troublesome times in America, and sometimes we get kind of overwhelmed by it all. And thinking about what to preach, obviously, a lot of things come through the mind. We can think about preaching on the problem of the sin nature. And I thought about preaching on Romans chapter 3. Thought about preaching on 1 Timothy chapter 3, and or 2 Timothy chapter 3, rather, where in the last days perilous times shall come. And it talks about the various issues of mankind and even the loves of man. It's a very interesting passage. It'd be great to preach on that sometime. But I felt like, and in praying about it, I just felt like what our people need and what you need and I need is our hearts to be warmed and encouraged with the promise of the blessed hope. I don't know about you, I'm tired of losing. I ran for Congress, glad I did, felt like I should do that, believed I should do that, and would do it again, and may do it again. But we didn't advance and didn't even get into the finals. That's okay. But I'm tired of losing. We want righteousness. I'm tired of seeing wickedness. I'm tired of seeing our streets in America on fire and people looting, and I'm just tired of things going wrong. We just recently had a Supreme Court ruling, another surprise defeat, frankly. I did not think that the court would go the wrong way this time, but I should have been more of aware, I suppose. But that advances the homosexual agenda, forces people to either not fire or not discriminate in hiring, even someone who maybe a man who comes in wearing a dress and applies for a job. I mean, you think about the fact that we're caving in to immorality, gender confusion. I'm just tired of losing. Do you feel that way? I think a lot of times we might. And I don't believe we should ever give up standing for Christ. We should not give up proclaiming the gospel. We should not give up even standing for righteousness, because people need to understand that God is holy and he's righteous and he demands righteousness of his creatures, who he's created, his people. And people are sinners and they've rebelled against the righteousness of God. And so we must lay upon them the demands of God's righteous law, God's righteous standard, to show them that they're sinners And then tell them there is a solution for their sin and the curse of sin and the judgment that will come with sin, and his name is Jesus Christ. And so we must stay faithful. We cannot be discouraged. Now, with that said, I want to bring some great encouragement to you tonight. And I want you to just tune out the news of the day and not worry about the things that's been going on, whether it's the coronavirus or whether it's riots or whether it's, who knows, just tune it out. We're in the house of God, at least as you sit at home and watch via video. We're fellowshipping over the internet together. We're sitting at the table of the Word of God together. And I want to tell you some good news. I want to tell you that I've read in the back of the Bible, I've read in the back of the book, and we win in the end. That righteousness will triumph. That Jesus Christ is coming again. And we need to be ready. And we don't have to lose heart. We don't have to be downcast. And we don't have to be defeated. And as Christians, our hearts can always be warmed and encouraged with the promise of the blessed hope of the second coming of Jesus Christ. Now, last time when I preached with you, we looked at a passage in 1 Thessalonians. We talked about the rapture and also the resurrection. But we said that was not the actual second advent. And there's much more we ought to talk about in 2 Thessalonians that we didn't get to, and maybe one day I'll get back to that. But today I want to go to the book of Revelation. And I want to ask you to take your Bibles, if you have them there at home, and open them up to Revelation chapter 19. Revelation chapter 19, and in just a minute we're going to begin reading in verse 11. Now, to a lot of people, the book of Revelation is just a bundle of mystery, and really folks struggle with understanding the book of Revelation. Can I just introduce the message with an overview real quick of the book and make it real quick, but to help you be able to understand that it's really not that complicated. Matter of fact, the key to unlock the book of Revelation is found in chapter 1. And in Revelation chapter 1, verse 19, the angel says to the apostle John, "Write, therefore, the things that you have seen, the things that are, and the things that are to take place after this." Now note, you have three things that John is supposed to write about. The things that you've seen, and I call that his previous experience, and that is covered in chapter 1. And then write the things that are, and that is the present exhortation at the time of John, and that's going to be the letter to the churches in Asia Minor, and that's going to be in chapters 2 through 3, the letter to the seven churches. That is the present tense at the time of John. Those churches were real churches that existed in Asia Minor, that is modern-day Turkey. And then he says, write the things which will come hereafter or to take place after this. And I call that prophetic events. And that's going to take you forward in chapter 4 on to the end of the book. So write the things which you've seen. That's the previous experience. The things that are, that's the present exhortation. And then the prophetic events. And that is beginning in chapter 4 and following. Now, in chapter 4 and 5, you have, and I'm going to subdivide the prophetic events. In chapter 4 and 5, you have the tribute to the Lamb. You'll remember in chapter 4, there's the worship in heaven, and it's the worship of the Father. And then that introduces, though, the worship of the Lamb in chapter 5, where Jesus Christ, the Lamb, is worshiped. And then you go from the tribute to the Lamb, which I call that, to the tribulation for the lost. And that is the largest part of the book of Revelation. That covers chapter 6 through chapter 19. And in that, the main outline of that, now you have some excursus that deals with some details. An excursus is like an appendices, but it's just dropped there in the passage. You have some detail passages that expand on other things, but the basic flow of history of the tribulation, the great tribulation, is right there in Revelation chapter 6 through 19. And it begins with seven seal judgments. And each seal is open. And then various tribulation occurrences come with each seal. Then the seventh seal is open. And with the seventh seal comes seven trumpet judgments. And so it's like you have six documents and then a folder. You open the last one, it's a folder, and you have six more in a sequence. It just layers and cascades in that way. So seven seal judgments, seven trumpet judgments, and when the seventh trump blows, you begin with seven bowl judgments, which are the final outpouring of the very wrath of Almighty God. And that will culminate with the Battle of Armageddon. It's prepared in the sixth bowl. And then the seventh bowl will encompass the final wrath being poured out, which will ultimately finally end when the Lord Jesus brings war, makes war, and destroys out of the sword out of his mouth those who are remaining, the remaining of lost mankind. And we'll see that tonight in our passage. So seven seals, seven trumpets, seven bowls, and that covers the tribulation for the lost. Now there will be saints saved. There will be the great witnesses there. There'll be the 144,000 there. There'll be a multitude of people who are martyred because they don't take the mark of the beast. And these will be people who are saved during the tribulation. But the tribulation for the lost is ultimately a judgment on lost mankind. And I believe the church will have already been raptured up out of that, although the book of Revelation does not give us those details. What it does tell us, though, that while this is going on earth, there will be the rejoicing over the destruction of Mystery Babylon and the great harlot. There'll be rejoicing by those raptured, resurrected saints in heaven. I believe we'll be a part of that rejoicing. And then there'll be the great marriage supper of the Lamb, and we'll take part in that as well, up in heaven, while the final events of the tribulation take place. But then we see in chapter 19, the glorious event, the second coming of Christ. And that brings us to the triumph of the Lord, which is in chapters 19, 20, and 21. In chapter 19, we see the second coming of Christ. Chapter 20, we see the thousand-year millennium. Chapter 21, we see the new heaven and the new earth and the new Jerusalem and the eternal state, what we'll be like forever in glory. And then chapter 22 closes out the book with a testimony to the listener. It's a great book, the book of Revelation. I encourage you just to read it over and over. And you say, well, I don't understand it when I read. Well, just read it over and over, study it and study it. And it's kind of like driving on a long road trip. I drive back home to my home state, Arkansas. And the first time I made a trip to California from Arkansas, or made a trip from California back to Arkansas, everything was new. But the more you make that same road trip, you recognize the stops, you recognize the restaurants, you recognize the best place to get gas at a good price, and you see this tourist event here, and you begin to understand. The more you travel that road, you begin to own it. And you could just ask guys who drive trucks cross country who make that route over and over. It becomes very familiar and very known to them. And that's the same with the book of the Revelation or any book in the Bible. And so I encourage you to study the book of the Revelation. Now, tonight, I want to talk to you on the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. In Revelation chapter 19, in verse 11, we have the key passage in the chronology of the book of Revelation, the passage that tells us of this event. Other passages in the New Testament allude to the event, point to the event. This is the event right here, foretold prophetically in Revelation chapter 19 and verse 11. It's one of my favorite, really one of my high favorite passages in all the Bible. It is such a source of encouragement. Everything that we long for, everything we yearn for as Christians, and the desire for our Lord and to be in His presence, the desire for righteousness and for Him to be vindicated, and everything that we desire, it will be culminated and brought to pass at the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Christian, we need to keep our eyes on the prize, the runner who keeps his eye forward and running toward that great a day of victory, that great finish line. That's what Christians, what the church needs to keep our focus on, is on Christ, the blessed hope, and not lose heart at this sin-sick world. We know that the Bible says that the Antichrist will come. We know that there will be the kingdom of Antichrist. We know that lawlessness will abound. We know that in the last days perilous times will come, and evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse. We know that while we may pray for revival, work for revival, work for reformation, work for righteousness, and do things to be faithful in our watch, that in the big scope, in the big picture, it's going to get bleak. It's going to get dark, but it's going to get real dark. But don't worry, because it's going to get real bright, and the Jesus Christ is coming again. So let's look at the Word of God. I invite you to look at Revelation chapter 19 and verse 11. And to begin with, we'll read verses 11 through verse 16. And that will be the main portion of our text in the Word that we want to address tonight. Revelation chapter 19 and verse 11. Hear the word of the Lord. Then I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse. The one sitting on it was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes are like a flame of fire, and on his head are many diadems. And he has a name written that no one knows but he himself. He's clothed in a robe dipped in blood, and the name by which he is called is the Word of God. And the armies of heaven, arrayed in fine linen, white and pure, were following him on white horses. From his mouth comes a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations. And he will rule them with a rod of iron. He will tread the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God, the Almighty. And on his robe and on his thigh, he has a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Again tonight, I want to talk to you on the subject, the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I want to outline our passage tonight and give you four main points with several subpoints. And so just buckle up, and we're just going to kick off and get going. The very first thing I want you to see is going to be the very coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Then we're going to talk about the character of the Lord Jesus Christ. Then we're going to talk about the company with the Lord Jesus Christ. And then we're going to talk about the cause of the Lord Jesus Christ. First of all, notice with me what I want to call the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. He, first under this point, he is coming out of heaven. Go to verse 11, if you will, and it says this, "Then I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, the one sitting on it is called Faithful and True," etc. He says, "I saw heaven open." And there is one coming out of heaven. His name is Jesus. Jesus Christ is coming out of heaven. In Revelation chapter 1 and verse 7, we see these. This also put this way. Verse 7, "Behold, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him, and all tribes of the earth will wail on account of him." Even so, amen. As a matter of fact, this passage says that Jesus is coming in the clouds. In the book of Daniel, we're told that Jesus, the Messiah, will come in the clouds. In the Olivet Discourse, we're told that Jesus will come in the clouds. He's coming out of heaven, meaning the abode of God, but he's coming even out of heaven, the very sky, with the clouds. And so, what a thing that will be, that all every eye will see him. Everyone will behold him. Those who pierced him will see him. All the tribes of the earth will wail upon account of him. Now, that should not surprise us, because do you remember what the angel said in the book of Acts? In the book of Acts, in chapter 1, when Jesus ascended up to heaven, it says in Acts 1:9, "And when he had said these things, as they were looking on, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. And while they were gazing into heaven as he went," Now just imagine Jesus at the ascension. This is there at the very end of his appearance on earth in the first coming. After the resurrection, he had been seen of many witnesses. He had done a conference of teaching the disciples some last words, and then he's caught up to heaven. He's lifted up into the clouds. He's lifted up and a cloud took him out of their sight. Verse 10, Acts 1:10, and while they were gazing into heaven as he went, behold, two men stood by them in white robes and said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into heaven? This Jesus, who was taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven." So, dear friends, just as Jesus was ascended up through the clouds into heaven, one day Jesus will descend out of the clouds into heaven in the same way. And so I can imagine, again, they looking up, their jaw just, and they're amazed. There he goes. And he's behind a cloud. He's gone. But in same fashion, dear friend, every eye one day will see him come out of the clouds. And with great astonishment, those who mocked him will be afraid now. Those who rejected him will be in fear now. Those who disbelieved him will know he's true now. And he's coming again. And he's coming not only out of heaven, but notice also he's coming on a horse. Look again in Revelation chapter 19 and verse 11. Then I saw heaven open, and behold, watch, and behold, a white horse. A white horse. The one sitting on him is called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he judges and makes war. Jesus is coming back on a horse. Now, the first time he came and he rode on a donkey, or on the foal of a donkey, the colt of a donkey. And you'll remember in Palm Sunday, we speak of that, and we talk about the time when they laid the palm branches down, and they shouted, "Hosanna in the highest." And he came on a humble beast. A donkey is a humble beast of burden. But when he comes again, he will not come humble on a beast of burden. He will come on a white horse. And the horse is a great, great animal with great nobility. And listen to what Job, in the book of Job 39, verse 18, has to say about the horse. Listen to what the word of the Lord says. Job 39, and listen to verse 18. Job 39 said 18, verse 19. The Lord is having interaction with Job, and the Lord says this: "Do you give the horse his might? Do you clothe his neck with a mane? Do you make him leap like the locust? His majestic snorting is terrifying. He paws in the valley and exults in his strength. He goes out to meet the weapons. He laughs at fear and is not dismayed. He does not turn back from the sword. Upon him rattle the quiver, the flashing spear and the javelin. With fierceness and rage he swallows the ground. He cannot stand still at the sound of the trumpet. When the trumpet sounds, he says, 'Ah!' He smells the battle from afar. He the thunder of the captains and the shouting." The horse is a great creature. And the Bible here depicts the horse as a creature for war. A horse which swallows up the ground in its galloping. A horse that is not afraid of the noise, of the clatter, the spears and the swords. A horse that is not concerned with the shouting and the fighting. And he, again, without fear, just gallops straight into battle. Jesus, when he comes again, he's not depicted as coming with a dove, a symbol of peace. When he comes again, he's not with a hunting dog to be able to search. When he comes again, he's not again coming on a donkey. When he comes again the second time, he's coming on a horse. And that speaks to why he's coming, and we'll say more about that in just a little bit. But it speaks to the warfare and the vengeance and the wrath that will be a part of his coming. And Jesus doesn't come with a horse of any color. The horse is not a sorrel-colored horse. The horse is not a speckled horse. The horse is not a pale horse. The horse is not a roan horse or a palomino horse. The horse is a white horse. And the color white speaks of purity. It speaks of righteousness. And the Bible tells us that in righteousness he judges and makes war. Look again in verse 11 at the end. He's called faithful and true, and in righteousness he judges and makes war. And the white horse is fitting. So the very first thing we see is just his actual coming. He's coming in the clouds, and he's coming on a horse. But I want to talk to you about something else. Not only do we see the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, but let's talk about the character of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible tells us right here a lot about Jesus in these few verses. First of all, we see his character by the designations by which he's called, the names by which he's called. I call it his designations. And he has four designations. First of all, look in verse 11, as we've just read. It says, "Then I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, the one sitting on it," now watch, "is called Faithful and True." Faithful and True. That is, the Lord Jesus is the one sitting on this horse, and he is here called Faithful and True. To be faithful is to be trustworthy, to be reliable, to keep the promises that you've made, and to be true is to be truthful and righteous and pure and true in every way. And Jesus Christ has that character. And this is really what I would call his saintly name. It speaks of his very character. Jesus is faithful and true. Men may let you down. The best of men may disappoint you, but Jesus Christ will never disappoint. Jesus Christ will never deceive. Jesus Christ will never lie. Jesus Christ is always reliable. He's kept his word. His word is faithful, he is faithful, and he is true. Then that's his saintly name. But I want to show you next his secret name. Look next, if you will, verse 12. His eyes are like a flaming fire, flame of fire. And on his head are many diadems or many crowns. And he, watch this, and he has, a name written. Do you see it? Another name. A name written that no one knows but he himself. A name written that no one knows but himself. This is what I call his secret name. You say, "Brother Sherwood, what is that name?" Well, I don't know what the name is. It says that no one knows but he himself. And how would I know if no one else knows? Now, there is speculation. And I will tell you this one thing. Maybe this might be the answer. The divine name of God in the Old Testament is four consonants in the Hebrew. It's Yod, He, Wah, He. Those consonantal letters we spell out YHWH. And there's been a lot of debate about what the vowels are and how many syllables there are. At one time, it was very popular for Bible scholars to say that the pronunciation should be JHVH. And they divided that up in three syllables, Jehovah. Now, most Bible scholars would not agree with that today. I don't agree with that today. I do not believe that is the divine name of God. What we can be probably more sure of is that the first syllable is Yah, Y-H, with the consonant, the vowel in between, A sound, Yah, Y-A-H. And that is because that is found in a lot of the names of in the Bible of people. They have the divine name, the abbreviated form of the divine name in there. And you may know the word hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallel is the Hebrew word for praise. And hallelujah, the Yah part, which in English is spelled J-A-H, which J is not in Greek or Hebrew. It's unfortunate that English puts J's in John and Jesus and James and all these. Russian Bible will not do that. It'll be more of a Y sound. So with the Ukrainian and so with the Greek, same with the Hebrew. And so actually, hallelujah, even though in English it's spelled at the end J-A-H, it's pronounced Y-A-H. And that Yah is the first part of the divine name. It's an abbreviation of the form of the divine name. It's called the Tetragrammaton. Yahweh is what we think is the best guess of the pronunciation of the divine name. It is not clear. It is definitely not certain. I think I read one time there are 17 possibilities. Don't hold me on that. Variations of what it could be with different vowel pointing and different syllabification. And you say, why are you getting into all this Hebrew stuff about the divine name and all of that? Well, I want to tell you that it's very possible that it is the correct pronunciation of the divine name. That could be what is the name that no one knows, because no one knows it, Protestant, Catholic, Orthodox, or Jew. No one knows the pronunciation of the divine name. It's long been lost because the vowel pointing was not carried on out of respect for not taking God's name in vain. So what is the secret name that no one knows? That may be it. Maybe it's something else. It's something that we don't know. So Jesus is described here with a saintly name, faithful and true. Jesus is described here with a secret name, a name that no one knows but he himself. And then Jesus is also depicted here with a scripture name. Look, if you will, in verse 13. He is clothed in a robe dipped in blood, and watch, and the name by which he's called, here's a third one. The name by which he's called is the Word of God. The Word of God. Jesus is called the Word of God. You remember in John 1, the Bible says in John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Then it goes on into verse 14 and says, and we beheld his image, the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. It says, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his image, etc. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. What is a word? A word is an expression of an invisible thought. And Jesus, as he became incarnate, became a flesh and dwelt among us. He is the express image, the visible image of the invisible God. And so Jesus is the Word of God. Jesus is the only person who could say, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. Jesus said, I and the Father are one. And so this is the Word of God, and Jesus is called the Word of God. So there is a scripture name. He's called the Word of God. And then there is a sovereign name. Look, if you will, in verse 16. And on his robe and on his thigh, he has what? He has a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Here, I call it his sovereign name. Jesus is not just a king, he's king over all kings. He's not just Lord, he's Lord over all lords. He is on the top. He is the ultimate supreme ruler of all of mankind, of all rulers and magistrates, and he is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He is sovereign. So we see about his character by his designations, his saintly name, faithful and true, his secret name, a name that no one knows but he himself, a scripture name, he's called the Word of God, a sovereign name, he's called King of Kings and Lord and Lords of Lord of Lord of Lords, and indeed he is. Not only do we see his character here by the designations, but by what he's called, but notice also with me his descriptions. There are two things about his personage, him, his very self, that describes him. One has to do with his eyes. That's in verse 12. The other has to do with his mouth. That's in verse 15. Look at his eyes. Verse 12, his eyes are like a flame of fire. What does this speak of? Jesus Christ returns. He comes again in his glorified state. He comes in fury of the wrath of God in verse 15. His eyes are omniscient. That is, he knows all, sees all, understands all. He reads the hearts of men. There's no one who could hide from him. No one can get away from his piercing sight, his penetrating sight, excuse me. And I believe that's what it is. He has penetrating sight. He's better than Superman. He has a way to look right into the hearts of each person, knows their thoughts, knows everything about them, knows where they are. He is with this sight. He's going to execute perfect judgment. And so he has penetrating sight, eyes like a flame of fire. And then notice his mouth. His mouth in verse 15. From his mouth comes a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations. And so Jesus is depicted as having a sharp sword out of his mouth. I don't necessarily believe that has to be a literal blade of steel. Perhaps it's what we think about in other passages in the Bible. In Ephesians 6:17, it says the Word of God is quick and powerful. Or that's Hebrews 4. 12 says the Word of God is quick and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit. The word of God is quick and powerful, sharper than a sword. It's like a sword. And of course, in the armor of God, in Ephesians 6, verse 17, take up the whole armor of God, it says, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And in Revelation, earlier in Revelation, chapter 1 and verse 16, maybe we can turn to that real quick. We see Jesus in the book of Revelation is depicted as the one who has the sharp sword coming out of his mouth. Look, if you will, 1:16, in his right hand, he held seven stars. From his mouth came, watch, a sharp two-edged sword, and his face was like the sun shining in full strength. And so that's how Jesus is depicted there. And not just there only, turn back over to chapter 2 and verse 12. And it says again about the sharp sword. And it said unto the angel of the church at Pergamum, write the words of him who has the sharp two-edged sword. And then in verse 16, he says, therefore repent. If not, I will come to you soon and war against them with the sword of my mouth. And so there again, we see this sword mentioned. And then we go back to our passage in chapter 19. Now in 19, it says in verse 15, from his mouth comes a sharp sword. Now I want to show you something else. Look, if you will, in chapter 19 at the very end in verse 21. And it says, and the rest were slain by the sword that came from the mouth of him who was sitting on the horse. And all the birds were gorged with their flesh. And so this sword is an instrument that will be used to kill and to vanquish. The Lord will vanquish himself upon his foes, and the wicked will be destroyed with the sword that comes out of his mouth. It says again, verse 15, from his mouth comes a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations. We're going to say more about this here in just a little bit about his cause and what he's going to do, but we see that even is linked to his very personage here and the language that John uses to describe him. He has eyes of fire. He said earlier in Revelation 1 that his appearance was so bright, it says the sun shineth in his strength. And then we see here that out of his mouth comes a sharp sword. That need not, again, I don't think, believe, have to be a blade, but the very piercing words. And he who was once pierced for our transgressions, he who was nailed and pierced by the nails, he who was pierced with the spear in his side, now he comes, and he comes again, and he's going to have a sword that will pierce and cut and bring judgment and bring vengeance on the wicked. And so we see his character depicted here by his designations, his names. We see his character depicted here by his descriptions, the eyes with a penetrating sight that can see and discern all things and judge all things. And with his piercing speech, with the word from the sword out of his mouth. And so with that, he will strike down the nations. But then there is some more to be said about the character of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I invite you to think with me about a third subpoint here. Not only his designations and his descriptions, but let's think about his dress. What he is wearing, what he has put on. And there are two things told to us about his dress. One is several crowns, and the other is stained clothing. Look in verse 12, and I want to show you the several crowns. It says in verse 12, his eyes were like a flame of fire. And now watch. And on his head are many diadems. Maybe your translation gives it crowns. A diadem is a crown. And he has many diadems. And of course, Jesus Christ has received in glory from the saints crowns cast at his feet. Maybe that's something to do with that. But I think actually it has more to do with the fact that he is King of Kings. And his reign is supreme. And in the Old Testament, kings like Nebuchadnezzar, when they conquered other kingdoms, they left those other kings in their kingdom, and he was over them, and they were vassal under him and would pay tribute to him. And so Nebuchadnezzar actually was called a King of Kings. Jesus Christ, we've said, is already the ultimate true King of Kings. And this is, I believe, depicted by these many crowns. And not only that, but notice also about his clothing, his stained clothing. And look in verse 13. And it says, he is clothed, now watch, he is clothed in a robe dipped in blood. Clothed in a robe dipped in blood. What is that? Now we find elsewhere he's got white linen, and we won't chase that, but here that probably still the same white linen, which speaks of purity and righteousness, is stained. It's stained with blood. It's dipped in blood. It's so stained with blood. It's as if, who knows if it's totally submerged or if it's just the bottom part. And I say that because I want to invite you to turn to a passage in Isaiah. Some people will say, well, maybe this is his own blood, and that could fit. Jesus did shed his own blood, and his garment would be stained with his own blood, perhaps, if you think of it that way, because he sacrificed himself on the cross to pay for our sins. But I actually don't think that's the best interpretation of what the blood is in this passage. In Isaiah chapter 63, listen to what it says in verses 1 and following regarding the judgment that is coming at the second coming. Isaiah 63, verse 1. Who is this who comes from Edom? Now, Edom is in the east of Israel, so the second coming from the east. It's not that he comes actually out of the country Edom, per se, as much as coming from that direction. Who is it that who is coming from Edom in crimsonized garments? Listen to that. In crimsonized garments from Bozrah. He who is splendid in his apparel, marching in the greatness of his strength. It is I, speaking in righteousness, mighty to save. Why is your apparel red and your garments like his who treads in the winepress? Answer, I have trodden the winepress alone, and from the peoples no one was with me. I trod them in my anger and trampled them in my wrath. Their lifeblood splattered on my garments and stained all my apparel. This is depicting the Son of Man coming back and treading the winepress of the grapes of wrath and the blood of mankind being splattered on his garments. And so I believe that that's what we have here. It says in verse 4 of Isaiah 63, for the day of vengeance was in my heart. And then he goes on in verse 5, I trampled down the peoples in my anger. I made them drunk in my wrath, and I poured out their lifeblood on the earth. Well, dear friend, I do believe that is what it's talking about here, and that Jesus, when he comes again, his garments will be stained in blood. You say, well, is it stained when he comes out of heaven on the horse, or is he referring to it being stained when he gets down to the earth and the battle ensues? Well, we'll find out when we're there. But nonetheless, I do believe that Jesus' garments are stained with blood, and so he has several crowns, and he has stained clothing. And this, again, tells us of what Jesus is about. It tells us about his righteous character. It tells us about his coming in vengeance. And all of these things fit with his dress, his descriptions, and his designations. Now, let me move on to a third main point. I've talked to you about the coming of the Lord Jesus. He's coming out of heaven. He's coming on a horse. I've talked to you about the character of the Lord Jesus. And we said you can know his character by his designations and his four names, and that you can know his character by his descriptions with his eyes and his mouth. And you can know his character even by his dress and what he wears. But now let me move on to a third point. Not only the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, not only the character of the Lord Jesus Christ, but I want you to think about the company with the Lord Jesus Christ when he comes again. Look now, please, at verse 14. And I love verse 14 because I believe that has you and me in it. Look at it with me. And the armies of heaven, arrayed in fine linen, white and pure, were following him on white horses. So Jesus, when he comes again, he's coming, and there's something following him. It's a huge gathering of horses with riders on those horses. And those riders are arrayed in fine linen, white and pure. Now, there are three things that are said in this verse about these people, the company that's coming with the Lord. First of all, they are described as an army. An army. And an army is aligned with its general. An army is aligned with its commander in chief. An army is aligned with its king. And here the armies of the Lord are his armies. And some might say, well, this might be angels because of that. And that is possible. And I'm not saying that angels aren't going to be a part of this, but we need to think more about it. But they're described as an army. And we'll see in later on in chapter 19, if you will, look at verse 19 of chapter 19. And I saw the beasts and the kings of the earth with their armies gathered to make war against him who was sitting on the horse and against his army. And we'll say more about that here in a little bit, but the army is with the Lord, and it is even subject to what will be the beast, the Antichrist, and his kings and his people will want to make war against Christ and against his army. Now, we'll say something about that here in a minute, but just realize that you have the description of those following on horses are called an army. Next, they are also said to advance. They are following. And so they're following him on white horses. They are not just standing up there at the top of the sky. They are following Christ as Christ comes. Now, when Christ comes again, where is he going to come? I don't want to take time on it too much, but Zechariah chapter 14 tells us, and maybe we should look at it. Let me go ahead and get you to look at it for a moment. You may not be familiar with this passage. So turn in your Bible, if you would, to Zechariah chapter 14. And in chapter 14, we see end time battle. We see the end time events with the second coming of the Lord. Listen to what it says in chapter 14 and verse 1. I'm in the book of Zechariah. It's in the Minor Prophets. Zechariah in the Old Testament, chapter 14 and verse 1. It says this, "Behold, a day is coming for the Lord." And then it goes on and describes this day. And I'll just keep reading. It says, "When the spoil taken from you," that's going to be Jerusalem, "will be divided in your midst." And I know that's Jerusalem because of the next verse. Verse 2, "For I will gather all nations against Jerusalem to battle. And the city shall be taken, and the houses plundered, and the women raped. Half of the city shall go out into exile, but the rest of the people shall not be cut off from the city." Now, this is the conditions that's going to take place here at the end time. It's going to be very tough for those who are in Jerusalem. And if you remember what Jesus said to those there in Olivet Discourse and so on. But look at verse 3 in Zechariah 4. Then the Lord will go out and fight against those nations as when he fights on a day of battle. Verse 4. On that day, his feet, whose feet? The Lord. When did the Lord have feet? The Lord has feet when Jesus' feet walks on the earth. When Jesus was incarnate, the Lord has feet. On that day, his feet, the Lord's feet, shall stand on the Mount of Olives that lies before Jerusalem on the east. And the Mount of Olives shall be split in two from east to west by a very wide valley, so that one half of the mount shall move northward and the other half southward, and you shall flee to the valley of the mountains, for the valley of the mountains shall reach to Azal, and yea, you shall flee. The you there is the Jewish people. I believe he's addressing that to the Jewish people. And you shall flee as you fled from the earthquake in the days of Uzziah, king of Judah. Now watch. Then the Lord my God will come, and all the holy ones, or all the saints, as the King James renders it, all the saints with him. And so Jesus Christ is coming again. Jesus Christ, we know where he's coming when he lands and his feet touches the earth. He's going to touch down at the Mount of Olives, which is on the east side of the city Jerusalem. And when he does, there's going to be an earthquake. And it's going to split open, and the mountains are going to split, and one part of the mountain will go one way and the other way. And what a great moment that will be. And notice it says at the verse 5 at the end, then the Lord my God will come. Jesus is God. Then the Lord my God will come, and all the saints with him are the holy ones. And again, some may take that to be angels, but I'm going to show you in just a minute why I think that is Christians who are already raptured and resurrected and in heaven. And so now we go back to Revelation chapter 19. And so it says that this company that comes with the Lord, it's described as an army. It's described as advancing and following Christ on white horses. And then it's also given their attire. And look, if you will, again in verse 14, and it says, and the armies of heaven arrayed what? They're dressed how? Arrayed in fine linen, white and pure. That is so important. That is a key. And that'll help us identify who is being spoken of here. And so I want you to look back. You're in Revelation chapter 19. That's verse 14. Would you back up just a few verses to verse 7 and verse 8? Now, in verses 6 through 8 is the account of the marriage supper of the Lamb. And so those who are saved will already be in heaven. In chapter 19, verses 1 through 5, they will rejoice over the judgment of the great prostitute. And they will be very thankful. We will be a part of that. And those who were martyred, they will be very thankful, for the Lord will have avenged her blood on his servants. But in chapter 6, and 6 through 8 is the great marriage supper of the Lamb. Excuse me, the marriage supper of the Lamb. Look at it. Let's just read it, verse 6 through 8. Then I heard what seemed to be the voice of a great multitude, like the roar of many waters, like the sound of mighty peals of thunder, crying out, Hallelujah! For the Lord our God, the Almighty, reigns. Let us rejoice and exalt and give him the glory. And here's why. Listen to it. For the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. This is the marriage supper of the Lamb. Jesus has come and taken his bride. I think I told you last time about the Jewish wedding and how that would work out, and that the wedding was probably prearranged anyway, along when the children were little. But at some point, the groom, a prospective groom, would make his proposal. They would become espoused. And then, as John 14 tells us, that the groom would go away and to prepare a place for her. And of course, Jesus has taken that as a parallel when Jesus said in John 14, Behold, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. Behold, I go to prepare a place for you, that I may come and receive you to myself. Where I am, there you may be also. And so, in same fashion, Jesus comes and grabs his bride. I say grabs his bride, snatched her up in the rapture and the resurrection. And of course, those who die during the tribulation, those tribulation saints, they ascend up to heaven. And so the bride of Christ is in heaven. And the saints who are the bride, here described as a bride. And of course, if you remember in Ephesians chapter 5, it describes the church as the bride of Christ. And so the bride is there, and the groom is there, and now the supper is ready in heaven. And also, if you remember in Ephesians chapter 5, it speaks of how Christ sanctifies the church and purifies it, that he might present it to himself, a spotless church without blemish. And notice what it says about the bride here in verse 7. Let us rejoice and exalt and give him glory. Give him the glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. It was granted her, watch to verse 8, it was granted her to clothe herself with fine linen, bright and pure. For the fine linen is the righteous deeds of the saints. This fine linen that's bright white, pure, clean, it's where we get the idea of a wedding gown on a wedding day and a bride wearing white. And the bride of Christ will wear white, fine linen, bright, clean, and it represents the righteousness of the saints. Now notice those terms in verse 8. Fine linen, bright, and pure. The ESV gives it pure, other translations clean. That's fine. Fine linen, bright and pure. Look again, and that's in chapter 19, verse 8. Look now in verse 14. And the armies of heaven arrayed what? Same description. Fine linen, white and pure. Beloved friend, who returns with Christ at the second coming on white horses? None other than the bride of Christ, who is in fine linen, white and clean. And I believe, dear friend, that's you and me. And while the unsaved humanity that's here on earth at that time and those who will come to believe at that time and all that will happen at that time with the judgment of the Antichrist and the false prophet and the kings of the earth, they will be looking up and they will be in fear and terror, but yet they will rebel still and go into war, and we'll see that. But they will all be looking up. Those who pierced him, they will look up and mourn for him, and all of mankind will mourn, and they're going to be afraid of him. But we're going to be coming and not looking up. We will have already been in heaven, and we'll be looking down. They will look as Jesus comes, and they will see him from the front. We'll be galloping on white horses, riding in the caravan, following him from behind, coming down out of the clouds. I can imagine the sky. I can imagine it blue. And the Lord Jesus, as the clouds break open, as he descends and the horse rears back and perhaps paws the air for a moment. And just in majesty, then the descent begins. And Jesus Christ begins to descend down to the earth. And the horse, the beautiful white horse that's so majestic is putting its hooves on thin air or on cloud bank and begins to gallop down. And then we, the armies which are in heaven, the bride of Christ, clothed in fine linen, white and pure, white and clean, we begin to gallop down. And I hope you're not afraid of heights, but I believe even if you are, it'll be okay by then. I mean, if you didn't get over the rapture or the resurrection, then this is going to be fine for you, because we're going to be glorified anyway. It won't matter. And we're going to come down out of the sky. We're going to be riding on our white horses, and we're going to be following him. Have you thought about it that way? I look forward to that day. I so look forward to being on the winning side. I so look forward to Christ being glorified and vindicated and he bringing in righteousness. I so look forward to the second coming of Christ, where he's going to reign supreme on the earth. I get ahead of myself, but I am so moved by verse 14. The company with the Lord Jesus Christ, those who are arrayed in fine linen, white and clean. Beloved, I believe with all my heart I'll be there. And I hope you're there too. Now I want to invite you to look at a fourth point with me, and it's the final point, and I want to say a few things about it, and we'll be done. We've seen the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. We've seen the character of the Lord Jesus Christ. We've seen the company with the Lord Jesus Christ. I want to show you lastly the cause of the Lord Jesus Christ. The cause. I mean, what is his agenda when he comes back? What is he going to do? Well, there's three things that I need to show you, and we've kind of alluded to it and pointed to it and said we'd get to it, and now we're here. Three things. First of all, we're going to see that he's going to come. When he comes, he's going to render a verdict. Secondly, when he comes, he's going to repay a vengeance. And third, when he comes, he's going to reign victorious. Reign is victorious. Let's look at it. Look in verse 11. Then I saw heaven open. Behold, a white horse. The one sitting on it is called Faithful and True. And in righteousness, what? In righteousness, he judges. This is why he has eyes as a flame of fire. He has this penetrating sight, and he knows all, sees all. The Bible says that Jesus Christ is the judge. He's going to be the judge even at the great white throne judgment. The resurrection of Christ guarantees that he'll be the judge. The Father judges no man, but he's given all judgment unto the Son. wherein he's given assurance unto all men in that he raised him from the dead. And so those who mocked Christ will now face him as judge. He will render a verdict on mankind. From this, there will even be later the great white throne judgment in Revelation chapter 20. But this is a judgment of mankind on the earth, a judgment on the Antichrist, a judgment on the false prophet, a judgment on all those who follow and take the mark of the beast. This is judgment. I hope you have no problem with God being judge. The liberal churches do. This world does. People may like the story of baby Jesus, and he did come incarnate as a baby. And we reverence that and respect that and celebrate the birth of Christ. But some want to leave him as a baby. But Jesus grew up to be a man. And he's not an ordinary man, he's the Son of God. And Jesus Christ, though when he came the first time, he did not come to judge. In John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And then it says, for God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world or judge the world, but that the world by him might be saved. When Jesus came the first time, he didn't come to judge. He came to save. But when he comes the second time, he does not come to save, he comes to judge. And he's right to do it. He's just to do it. And he will do it accurately in truth and faithfulness and righteousness. He will judge. He comes to render a verdict. He also comes to repay a vengeance. You said vengeance? Yes. The Bible says, vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. In the book of Hebrews chapter 10, people say, don't want a God of vengeance. But if they read Hebrews 10, it says, for we know him. We know him who hath said, vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. It is a fearful thing to fall in the hands of the living God. God will get vengeance through his Son, Jesus Christ. Christ will get vengeance. He will repay a vengeance. Look again in verse 11. It said, we already said that he's called faithful and true and in righteousness. He judges, but watch the last line. He judges and makes war. The first time he comes, he's the Prince of Peace, and he comes to bring peace and bring reconciliation between God and man. When he comes again, he comes and makes war. Again, look, if you will, in verse 15, from his mouth comes a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations. When he makes war very well. He will rule them with the rod of iron. We'll come back to that. He will tread, watch it, he will tread the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God the Almighty. Jesus Christ is going to come, and he's going to step on mankind and crush the grapes of humanity, and the blood of mankind will splatter on his raiment, and he will trample out mankind with the word out of his mouth, with the sword out of his mouth, just like someone would take off their shoes and wash off their feet in the Bible days and step into a wine vat and begin to stomp on grapes to squeeze out the juice, the blood of the grape. He will tread the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God the Almighty. And that's just the beginning, because hell awaits next. I want to, before we go to the final point, I want to read a little more out of this. And so you'll see this repaying of vengeance and this war when he makes war. Look in verse 17, and I want to read through verse 21. We're in Revelation 19. This is going to describe this event. Then I saw an angel standing in the sun, and with a loud voice he called to all the birds that fly directly overhead, come, gather for the great supper of God, to eat the flesh of kings, the flesh of captains, the flesh of mighty men, the flesh of horses and their riders, and the flesh of all men, both free and slave, both small and great. And I saw the beast, And the kings of the earth with their armies gathered to make war against him who was sitting on the horse and against his army. And the beast was captured, and with it the false prophet who had who in his presence had done the signs by which he deceived those who had received the mark of the beast and those who worshipped its image. These two were thrown alive into the lake of fire that burns with sulfur, and the rest were slain by the sword that came from the mouth of him who was sitting on the horse. And all the birds were gorged with their flesh. This is the final wrath of God on mankind on the earth. This is the final aspect of the seventh bowl poured out, where Jesus Christ returns himself and brings vengeance and repays vengeance and tramples the wicked in the wrath, the fierce wrath of the Almighty, like treading grapes in a wine vat. And Jesus, again with the sharp sword out of his mouth, brings vengeance. All that is wrong and evil will be corrected on that day. All that is sinful and rebellious will be put down that day. All defiance and mockery will be turned right side up as it is put down that day, and righteousness will reign supreme. Christ will be exalted. The only survivors going into the millennial kingdom will be saints who have never died, who are saved at the end or somewhere in the tribulation, and they make it through it. And others will be those who return in a glorified state. That will be those who've been at the marriage supper of the Lamb. And that would be you and me. And so Jesus comes, the cause of the Lord Jesus Christ. He renders a verdict, he judges. He repays a vengeance, he makes war. He also reigns victorious. Final thing I want you to see. Go back to chapter 19 and look at what it said in verse 15. From his mouth comes a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations. Now watch. And he will rule them with a rod of iron. He will rule them with a rod of iron. There will be nations, people of ethne. The ethne is the Greek word for nations. Ethnics, all the ethnic people, all the peoples of the world. There'll be some who make it into the millennial kingdom from every ethnicity. And he will rule with a rod of iron. Now, chapter 20 tells us about that, and I'm not going to preach on chapter 20 tonight, but I just want to show you a couple things and on this point where he reigns. Look in chapter 20, and so you see that the devil is bound and put in the abyss, the bottomless pit, in verses 1 through 3. And then verse 4, you see thrones seated. John says, "Then I saw thrones, and seated on them were those to whom the authority to judge was committed." I believe that is the bride. I believe that's us in the glorified state. Also, I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded for the testimony of Jesus and for the word of God. Those are the saints who get saved during the tribulation, and they're martyrs because they would not take the mark of the beast. Those who had not worshiped the beast or its image and had not received its mark on their foreheads or on their hands. They came to life and watch and reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. And then you see this term reigning again. For sake of time, just skip down to the middle part of verse 6. And it says, but they will be priests of God and of Christ, and they will reign with him for 1,000 years. Reign, thrones and judgment. And so Christ will reign for 1,000 years, and we will reign with him for 1,000 years, and Jesus Christ will reign victorious, and you have the millennial kingdom for 1,000 years. What a glorious event that will be. So the cause of the Lord Jesus Christ, he renders a verdict, guilty. He repays a vengeance. He makes war, and with a sharp sword out of his mouth, he strikes down the nations, and he treads the winepress of the wrath, the fierce wrath of the God Almighty. And then not only does he repay a vengeance, then he reigns as victorious, and that takes you in to the millennial kingdom. Our God reigns. Jesus Christ is King of kings and Lord of lords, and he will reign. God will reign through his Son, Jesus Christ, on that day. Now, the kingdom is in our hearts if we're Christians. Where the king is, there's the kingdom. And where we yield and submit to him as our king and Lord, there he is. But one day, he's coming again. And his kingdom will be established on earth. And the prayers of Christians throughout the thousands of years now, a couple of thousand years of prayers, we prayed, "Our Father, which art in heaven, Hallowed be thy name, thy what? Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That's going to be answered in perfection one day. That prayer will be answered in perfection one day. I tell you, don't be discouraged, dear friend, with this sin-sick world. You say, what is the world coming to? What is the world coming to? I'll tell you what it's coming to. It's coming to Christ, the second coming of Christ and the kingdom of Christ, and he will reign supreme. He will render a verdict. He will repay a vengeance, and he will reign as victorious. And beloved friends, I tell you, I've read the back of the book, and we've looked at it tonight together, and we win in the end. If you're a Christian, don't be discouraged. Don't be downcast at the mockery and the foolishness of the wicked. This is all in God's plan. The rebellion of the people of this world and the kings of this world, the rulers, the judges, the Antichrist, all of that is a part of God's plan. But if you are a worshiper of the Lord Jesus Christ, you're saved, you're his child, you're part of his bride, you have every reason to lift up your head with rejoicing tonight. It's a lot to take in, isn't it? It's an amazing thing. Just imagine, again, the sky opening up, and there you are behind the Lord, descending and coming down to the earth. Having partaken of the marriage supper of the Lamb, having your garments in fine linen, white and pure, and then entering into his kingdom. We don't have to fight the Antichrist. With the sword out of his mouth, it's over. And the wicked are judged. And the birds assemble to gorge on the flesh of kings and captains and horses and riders and slave and free and small and great, all who took the mark of the beast, all who were in defiance and rebellion to Jesus Christ. The judgment's come. Christ has come. And we enter into his reign for 1,000 years. And then you read on in chapter 21, you see the new heaven, new earth, and the eternal state, and it's going to be glorious. I look forward to it, dear friend. And I hope that you in your heart, while we are thankful for our life on this earth and we want to make everything as well and be faithful under our watch, proclaim the gospel, exalt Christ, and make righteousness Christ known and righteousness the righteous standard known and all of these things. But it's in God's hands. It's in God's control. And we know we're saved. If you know that you know that you know that you're saved, it's all right. Now, I'm about to close out and close in prayer, but before I do, what if you're not saved? Friend, this is not make believe. This is not fiction. Jesus Christ is real, and he's coming again. We don't know when. We don't know when the rapture is. We don't know when these events will take place. You need to be ready. And if you're not right with God, I call you to repent and get right with God. Why rebel against the Son of God? Bow in repentance and faith and trust Christ as your Lord and Savior and pledge and say, Lord, I want to serve you. You're not going to be saved by how you serve. You're saved by what he did for you on the cross and his glorious resurrection. But as a child of God, say, even tonight as a Christian, maybe you want to say, Lord, I want to follow you better. I want to serve you better. Forgive my sin. Help me to live for you. Your Lord, your King of Kings, your Lord of Lords. If you're not saved, I invite you to trust Jesus Christ. He came the first time to save. You can be saved if you'll repent and trust Christ. If you wait, when he comes the second time, it's too late. He'll come in judgment. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for your word. We thank you that it is such an encouragement. It is an astonishing thing to behold. It's shocking in some respect. We try to visualize it in our minds, what this is going to be like. We believe it to be true because it is your holy word. Now, Lord, the details, perhaps even in my preaching of it, there's been some mistakes. Lord, I offer this sermon to you and pray that whatever has been said that is faithful and true to the meaning of the text, that it would stick and penetrate the heart, anything that is a mistake, Lord, that it would be soon forgotten. Lord, we know that you're coming again. We know, Lord, that your word is clear about these things. And so, Lord, we rejoice. We thank you. Lord, I just seem a little astonished myself as the one who has preached this message and bathed my soul in these words. It's so overwhelming, so wonderful, so blessed. And Lord, we want to see people saved. We'd rather see them saved than judged on that day. But Lord, we want you to vindicate yourself. We love you so much. We don't want your name blasphemed anymore. We don't want you mocked and ridiculed anymore. And Lord, we know that one day you're going to make it right. And all this wickedness that we see in our world that just pains our hearts. Oh God, one day you're going to make it all right. Everything that is upside down, you'll turn right side up. We know, Lord, in the first time when you came in mercy. When you come again, you'll come in judgment. The first time you came meek and lowly. When you come again, you're going to come high and mighty. The first time you came and you rode on the colt, the foal of a donkey. When you come again, you're coming on a white horse. The first time you came, Lord, you came and you were killed. When you come the second time, you will come in righteousness, kill the wicked. Well, the first time, Lord, you came, you laid aside the prerogatives of your deity. When you come again, you're going to execute your prerogatives of deity. When you came the first time, people mocked you and ridiculed you out of their mouth, but when you come again the second time, out of your mouth will come a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations. Lord, we long for your coming. We look to your coming. We say, as John says at the end of this book of Revelation, even so come, Lord Jesus. And as we live our lives, as people marry and have families and work and play, and as we, as your bride, your Christians, your church, as we worship you here on earth and we go about the course of our life, help us to live in anticipation of this moment. Help us to keep our eyes on the finish line. And help us to glorify you always in anticipation. And let every man who has this hope purify himself even as you are pure. Help us, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
For my
needs a friend, so I run to the Father again and again and again.
Thank you so much for this time that we've had together this evening. I thank you for each and one of these people that are here that are tuning in with us online. I thank you for your church, God. I thank you for your promise to us. And I just ask that as we depart from here today, that we press forward and have our hearts set on you, God. Wherever we go, whatever we're doing, that we shine you, God, and that you can be seen through us. And I pray all this in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, church. I hope you guys have a great week.